So this graphic is going to walk us through the steps of meiosis, and alongside I have mitosis, so we can kind of compare and contrast as we go through these different steps. So remember, meiosis is going to have the same set of steps: prophase, metaphase, anaphase, and telophase. And some of the same basic things are going to happen. The nucleus is going to disappear, chromosomes become visible, lining up in the middle, pulling apart, splitting into two cells. That is the same basic idea. But what I'm going to highlight is how meiosis is different from mitosis. And then, of course, in meiosis, we're going to go through an entire second set of cell divisions so that we end up with four cells instead of just two. So in prophase one, in addition to the nucleus disappearing and chromosomes become visible, homologous chromosomes are going to pair up, and this is a process called synapsis. Now remember, homologous chromosomes are the chromosomes with the same set and order of genes, and because they have the same basic order, they match up perfectly, and so they can sort of wrap together. The different genes line up perfectly. We have the different colors here representing one set that comes from mom, one set that comes from dad. During synapsis, something happens called crossing over, and it turns out that as these homologous chromosomes are in synapsis, they're so close together that they can actually trade small pieces. And what that's going to look like on a graphic here is that our blue chromosome is going to end up with a little red tip, and the red chromosome will end up with a little blue tip. It's an equal exchange of information, but it's just shifted from one homologous chromosome to the next. And this is one of the key steps to getting additional genetic diversity into our gametes. Remember that at the end of meiosis, all of the cells are going to be genetically unique, and crossing over is going to be a key part of that. Next, we go to metaphase one, and in this step, homologous pairs line up next to each other in the center of the cell. So again, metaphase, they're lined up in the middle, but unlike mitosis, in meiosis, they're not lined up end to end. Instead, your homologous pairs are still together. And sometimes this is referred to as tetrads lining up. And you can see why, because it looks like we have sort of four pieces. Notice the result of a crossing over event is depicted here as well. This step is where we also see something called the law of independent segregation. And what that says is the orientation of these two chromosomes is completely independent of the orientation of these two chromosomes. What I mean by that is if we have a blue chromosome on this side and a red on this side, that doesn't mean that we have to have blue on this side and red on this side. It's a 50-50, totally random chance which side the blue ones end up and which one the reds end up. And I think if you just look at this simple cell, that seems not very difficult or interesting. This is a 2n equals 4 cell. There are a total of 4 chromosomes. But remember, in humans, we have 46 chromosomes, or 23 pairs. And so we would have 23 of these tetrads. And you can imagine there's all kinds of different combinations: all blue on one side, all red. One blue, the rest red. Half blue and the other half red. You can have all of these different combinations. And in fact, all of the different ways that those can orient can give you 8 million different combinations just based on this law of independent segregation. Now you're going to get even more diversity just because of the crossing over events as well. I should add, back to crossing over, that a typical human chromosome will undergo 3 crossing over events. And again, you have 23 pairs, and they're all going through these crossovers, and you start to see how much genetic diversity we can potentially get in our sperm or egg. In anaphase 1, homologous pairs are separated by the spindle fibers, but notice the sister chromatids still stay together. And again, this is the third of the key steps in meiosis that are very different from mitosis. So then we have telophase occur, just like in mitosis. The cell splits into two through cytokinesis, and new nucleus forms. And at the end of our first cell division, we end up with two cells. And instead of stopping here, we're going to immediately go through a second set of cell divisions. And what's important here is we're not going to stop and replicate our DNA. We're just immediately going to go through a whole nother set of prophase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase. So imagine these chromosomes line up in the middle, the spindle fibers pull the sister chromatids apart, and we're going to end up with one cell that has small red, and then it's got one side of this larger chromosome with that crossing over, and then the other half are going to end up in this cell. Our second cell is going to go through the same prophase, metaphase, anaphase, telophase two, and split into these two different cells. So I want you to notice here that our original cell had four chromosomes. We now have each cell only has two chromosomes. And because of the crossing over events, each one of these cells is unique. So if we compare the final products between mitosis and meiosis, in meiosis we end up with four cells, and in mitosis we end up with two. In meiosis, all four of these are genetically unique, where in mitosis, each of these is genetically identical. So this next video is just a nice summary of the process of meiosis, and it will hopefully give you a visual of how this process works.